Inadequate fence. Unexpected explosion. A lick from behind.
This week on Backward Compatible, the crew is joined by special guests Adam Brackin and Will Parsons to compare storytelling and presentation in tabletop versus video games. Plus, Chris creates a video game haiku competition. Backward-Compatible.com podcast starts right now.
Welcome, Backward Compatible listeners. This is podcast number 7. I'm Chris, and I'm here with Richard.
Hi.
I'm here with Jim.
Hello.
And we also have two very special guests today. We've got...
special,
yeah. We have Dr. Adam Brackin, formerly a professor of ours. And we also have Will Parsons.
Correct? Hey.
I see your name on Facebook as Will These Hats. I just want to make sure I'm not misremembering.
Either one works. Will These Hats is more easily recognizable due to Parsons being super
common. What is up with that name, by the way? These Hats? No?
It's based on the idea that I was going to have a different type of hat for everything I was doing. So my articles were going to be Will News Hats.
Oh, okay.
My games, like the stories I was writing would be Will Writer's Hat, Will, and just
sure,
change the hat for every game.
And you're a man of that many hats.
I have like several hats, actually.
I keep expecting you to wear some of them, but I never see them.
I've worn a few. Like,
you know, you would think as like a big Texas native, I would have like a cowboy hat. But the only cowboy hat I have is actually a straw hat that my wife and I got from Vegas. So I was like the Texan in Vegas who bought a terrible straw cowboy hat.
You hayseed. Yeah. Cool. So Doc, how about you introduce yourself, sort of give us some background on your credentials?
Oh, okay. I've written a few things in the gaming world. I wrote an article for Dungeons and Dragons and Philosophy, which is a part of the Pop Culture and Philosophy series. I've written a couple of articles and gone to Oxford to present those with you once, Richard.
Yeah, I remember that.
You may remember that.
Faintly.
Yeah. But and as mentioned, I was a professor for about 7 years, and now my full-time job is taking care of my baby.
Congratulations.
Literal baby.
Pretty awesome. Being a full-time dad, and that's given me a chance to do some writing.
Cool.
So I'm doing a couple secret projects that I can't talk about, but the one that I can talk about is Lab Ventures. That's my YouTube channel, and so we're still trying to twist you guys' arm to recast onto Lab Ventures. Just let me know.
Oh yeah,
when you want to do that, and we'll make that happen.
Okay, eventually.
Yeah. We're a family show, though, so not going to be able to do the ones with the swearing. So this will be the first one that we'll be able to recast, but
yeah.
That's okay.
Any podcast that has Ben on it will be totally unavailable.
Yeah.
But, yeah, our thing is that a lot of Minecraft, and we've been playing recently the new Creativerse that just came out, which is...
Okay, is that why Minecraft just had, like, the top Twitch viewership from, like... I was just on Twitch, like, 2 or 3 days ago, and I was looking for stuff to watch while I was writing, and I was like, how is Minecraft higher than, like, League of Legends and Dota and Hearthstone, right? There were, like, 200,000 people watching Minecraft on Twitch. And I know that Minecraft is popular, but typically not for live streams.
Well, it's been in the news recently because there was a Minecon that was not the official one, but an unofficial one that was supposed to happen. But the $500,000 worth of receipts just kind of went missing.
And I saw that. Yeah.
So there's a big stink in the Minecraft community right now. Everybody's kind of talking and showing their rage by building 1 meter by 1 meter at a time.
Man, with this and the Yogg Ventures Kickstarter issues and all that, there's kind of a lot of drama in the Minecraft community now.
There truly is. Well, the problem with that particular example, and don't get me wrong, that's one of the few Kickstarters I've ever actually kicked in for. The Yogg Ventures. I think that they probably spent a little too much money on their offices and not quite enough money on hiring the developers that they needed to hire. Because the version that I played, which was a very late version, felt very, very early. So I was kind of sad. But I got to say, Professor Phil Johnson, he's still alive. Former Professor Phil Johnson, was kind enough to give Lab Ventures a couple of keys, and so we've played with their new creative verse over at Playful, which is just up the road, actually, I'm not sure exactly where, but it's in Dallas.
That's a really cool thing about Dallas. We have some pretty awesome studios just around the corner.
We got tons of them. So, I mean, you know.
It's not too far away.
Yep. Yeah. Gearbox are the big ones. Yeah.
Doesn't Blizzard also have a studio out here?
Yeah, I think so.
I know they always have, like, internships available.
Yeah, I thought it was just, like, an office.
It's an office. Tony Wu.
Tony Wu.
Oh, is he?
Oh, okay. Yeah, that's right.
I don't know if he is anymore, but he was for a while. Yeah. But at any rate, so if you're out there lamenting the loss of your Yog Ventures, I recommend Creativerse. It's worth the $20. You get 400 in-game credits. Pretty soon it'll be free. I got to admit, though, sorry, Playful. There is one that is still closer to my heart that's about to come out, and that's Fortnite. I am super excited about Fortnite. Yeah, the way Fortnite's going to work is it doesn't have anything to do with blocks. You actually put the walls up, and you have plans. And so whenever you go out there into this post-apocalyptic world, you discover the plans for the buildings, and you can come back and build your fort. And it's got all that, just like being 8 years old and building a fort out of boxes.
Nice.
And also zombies. So,
and also zombies.
You know, everybody's, I don't know if everybody's tired of the zombies. Some people say they are. I'm not tired of zombies.
Now, are you building your forts out of zombies? Like zombie parts?
You know, it might be true. I don't know. But the cool thing about it is it's actually the team that brought Gears of War. So
what?
Yeah, believe it or not. So it's kind of an about face for them. They started out... I read an article about this. I really have nothing to do with it, and I don't know this authoritatively, but I read something.
On the internet?
Yeah, professors do that. No, this was on paper. They still do print things on
paper. Wow, really?
Yeah. In a magazine, no less.
It's shocking.
I know. Yeah, it's crazy. one of the things that they started out was to make it very, very serious. They tried to make that tone very serious and very quickly realized that you cannot seriously pull off, I'm going to build a wall in 3 seconds. You've got to go Wile E. Coyote on it. If you don't see the little puff of smoke and the hammer sounds, it's just not going to work. So that's what we've done. Yeah, exactly. So that's kind of where it's gone.
Awesome.
So those are the things I'm looking forward to. And you know, since that one's free to play as well, with microtransactions, which people are kind of screaming about right now with Creativerse, a lot of negative pushback on that. So we'll see how it works for Fortnite. But the new model for these kind of building games is microtransactions.
All right. Well, thanks for joining us, Adam. Now we turn to the master of puns, as he's been right here.
He's a funny guy.
Will.
Put me on the spot now.
Be funny, Will.
Oh, great.
Right now.
Great. I'm just going to remain silent.
True comedians can deal with hecklers in the audience.
Well, I'm not a true comedian.
Is that why we use puns?
Yes. Good job being funny, eh?
All right. So tell us a bit about you, Will.
Right now I work as a corporate copywriter, so... Not very flashy, but I get to practice writing. It's all tied to me. It's about light bulbs. It's not all that interesting. But I'm also working on a couple of projects involving interactive narrative. There's a couple of things that really bother me about the way stories are done right now. And so I'm trying to fix all that by writing my own stuff that may not be executed as spectacularly, but the things that bother me about what's currently being done will not be in mine, and that's what I'm hoping for. And I'm hoping to bridge like 3 or 4 different styles, 3 or 4 different platforms into one story. Not one story, sorry. 3 or 4 different stories that are on 3 or 4 different platforms, but all in the same universe.
Okay.
So it's all one large story, but you can pick and choose which ones you want without being affected on the others.
And by platform, do you mean like, say, one's on PC, one's on like a smartphone, one's maybe like a role-playing game, one's a book, that sort of thing? Or
kind of, yeah.
So it's like transmedia storytelling?
Yeah. Okay. Yeah.
Cool.
Exactly.
Transmedia, what's that?
We're not going into there.
That's another topic for another day.
We're shutting that door right now.
But cool. I actually did write a paper on that. It was called my dissertation. So.
Oh, yeah, was it?
You ever want to know...
All right, so to get us started today, I have devised a little game. So
we don't do games on this podcast.
We don't do games on this podcast. Only serious.
This is serious business.
Is this ludic activity?
You said yes. Earlier you didn't want to use the term ludic, so...
Oh, no, that was just Jim.
Okay,
no,
just Jim.
I can't use it.
You can't use ludic. Yeah. I guess you can call it ludic.
It's like me, I'm not allowed to say ludonarrative dissonance.
But you just did.
You just did.
I broke the rules.
We'll cut that out.
It's like in Monty Python where you've got it, that whole thing.
We need to have an editor that we can yell at over the mic.
Cut that out.
Right. So, what I've prepared for you guys today is a little haiku game. I've taken different video games or video game series, and I've written a haiku that's supposed to sort of summarize what happens in it.
Are they good haikus?
Well, that remains to be seen. I do not claim to be a trained haiku writer. So I
haiku writer.
How much time did you spend on these haikus?
Haikuist.
Actually, I spent like all together, not all of it, like writing straight, just kind of brainstorming, tabbing back and forth doing different things. Probably a good 3 hours.
Okay, now they've got to be good.
They better be really good.
I hope so.
Because if you said 5 minutes, you would have had an excuse.
Yeah. Well, on each one, I think ultimately it was about 5 minutes.
What he's not sharing is that they're actually in calligraphy.
Oh, right.
Calligraphy on my smartphone. Yes.
Are these actual like haiku? Silk
screens.
Like you include the full stop and the pause stop, and then you also have a reference to the season?
Not necessarily, no. It's more just, okay. It's more 5-7-5.
Well, bring on the 24 haikus then.
All right. It's 15, actually.
Oh.
So we're going to have two rounds. The first round is going to be the first 10. The idea here is that I'm going to read the whole haiku, so no butting in early. But as soon as the haiku's done, whoever sort of like raises their hand or shouts or whatever first, I'm going to call on them. I'm
looking at you, Jim.
They have to try to name the gamer series. Now, it's not going to be the specific game. So, like, I didn't do Legend of Zelda, for instance.
Okay.
We're not looking for Ocarina of Time or Majora's Mask. We're just looking for Legend of Zelda. You get 2 points in the first round for answering correctly. You lose a point if you answer incorrectly.
Okay.
So you want to be confident when you give your answer.
Now, are these Sega Genesis games?
some might be, some might not be.
So. All right.
Now, that article I read.
Did you?
Okie doke. So I guess we'll go ahead and get started with the first one. So here we go. Angelic terrors, slain with bullets, spells, and style. Not enough shampoo.
Say the first one again?
Well,
okay.
Bayonetta.
Correct.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, are you going to be doing new games?
Some are new, some are old.
I was going to go with Devil May Cry. So
yeah, Jim is at an inherent disadvantage being the retro guy.
He said shampoo, and then I was like, is that a name? Nope, it's hair product.
I never even played Bayonetta.
What's funny is when he said shampoo, the first thing that came to mind was Sephiroth.
Any JRPG.
Same really. Here, but I was like, the rest of it doesn't fit.
Yeah. So you were thinking Donkey Kong? Well, that would have been real poo, sorry.
He uses shampoo. Oh.
Think about that one. You'll get it later.
All right. Yeah. Yep, got it.
Okie doke. Number two. And keep up track of your own scores. I'm not going to remember everyone's.
Great, thanks.
You're welcome. All right. Sudden rush of wind. Creatures spring from metal shells. Footprints in the dust.
Sudden gust of wind.
Oh.
Yeah.
Pokemon.
Incorrect.
No, wait.
Too late.
Too late.
You were wrong.
Say that again?
All right. Sudden rush of wind. Creatures spring from metal shells. Footprints in the dust.
Tell me I'm wrong with Pokemon.
I'm just going to... I'm just going to go ahead and guess Sonic the Hedgehog.
Correct.
Oh, very nice.
I am ashamed. I did not get that.
No.
You knew it was coming at some point.
Yeah.
No.
I can't believe I didn't get that.
We missed... Oh, we have two Sonic fanboys at the table now.
Yep. There you go.
You know, sadly, I've never played a single Pokemon game.
Mm. I see where you're coming from with the footprints.
Well, yeah, and not only that, but the little metal shells, right? I mean, Pokeballs?
Yeah, it's a good point. Huh? I guess I never thought of Pokeballs as being metal because, like, all the props are plastic.
I don't. I'm not so sure. Well, hold on. I'm not so sure they are metal, actually.
Yeah.
I'm not so sure. I think they actually are supposed to be a hard plastic.
Mm.
Pretty sure they're made by Capsule Corp, so...
All right, now we're just going across all the different universes.
That's from
Dragon Ball, yeah.
But I've never seen either.
What's funny is, actually, I also thought Cybermen when I heard that.
So do I actually have a negative score?
You have a negative one.
Negative one. That's excellent.
I like
brutal!
Putting down
brutal.
The dark side point to mark your negative
point. We're not playing around with this game.
I am so sad I didn't get that.
Yeah, I'm going to use the Empire symbol here, since we've got all our Star Wars RPG stuff out.
Yeah.
Oh, God.
So, all right, next one. All risen sit down. Condemning glares fall on one. Outstretched arm defends.
Phoenix Wright.
Correct.
Objection.
Objection. Hold it. All right.
Oh, yeah.
Research gone awry. Hell musters in the heavens. One man and a gun. Yeah.
Half-Life.
Incorrect.
Man.
Yeah.
Mega Man.
Incorrect.
Ah. Say it again.
Research gone awry. Hell musters in the heavens. One man and a gun.
I don't know the second line.
Yeah.
I'm going to say Doom.
Correct.
It fits Doom, but I don't know.
Okay. It's Doom.
Yeah. I was thinking Doom at first, and then I go, there's no way you would.
The idea Doom, being that it's okay. Mars, and Mars is in the heavens to us. So. Yep,
which is why I went with Half-Life.
Oh, there you go.
I didn't know the whole research angle to Doom.
Yeah, he goes into a research, abandoned research base.
Now,
that's how they open the portal.
Thinking about the movie with The Rock, I now understand.
Oh, come on.
That's your definitive source.
You should see Jim's face right now.
But did you watch the extended edition with an extra 7 minutes of first-person perspective?
I did not.
You didn't see the movie.
Oh, I've got to go back. All right. We had a whole conversation.
I only watched that one part, but...
Next time I'm Backward Compatible, we watch Doom and comment. All right. So, next haiku. City under siege. Slashes upon scorched rooftops. Bullets miss their mark. Yeah.
Rampage.
No.
Rampage?
That was not bad. That was not bad. I don't know how that's funny. That was actually a pretty good guess.
That was a good guess, actually.
They made a board game out of that.
It's a better game than Bayonets. Yes. Come on.
Was it actually, like, was it just sort of like a... evocative of Rampage, or was it actually like licensed?
No, it's got the Lizzie and everything. I mean, it's straight up, you eat humans, it's fantastic. Nice. I haven't played it.
That sounds pretty neat, actually.
I know, I want to pick it up.
I'd like to play it.
Yeah.
Say it again.
Okay. City under siege, slashes upon scorched rooftops, bullets miss their mark. If everyone passes, we can just move on.
I'm gonna have to pass.
I don't trust my guess well.
Yeah, I don't trust my own guess. Okay. Yeah.
I have a guess, but I just don't. It's pretty out there. Well, it's not that.
You're
out.
Doing well with points.
Nah, I don't know about that.
My goal is to have the least number of points.
The slash
it's Garf, right?
The slashes part is throwing me off.
Okay. So nobody wants to guess?
No. I'm going to go ahead and do it.
Okay.
Final Fantasy.
Incorrect.
Man.
Sorry.
I was thinking the movie, but... You know.
This is not a real guess, so if I'm right, I don't get the point. But Prototype?
No. Sorry. It was Strider.
I was gonna say Strider, and I go, oh, but the okay.
And you didn't, did you?
I know. I need to actually make my real guesses because I've been right so far. Okay.
Okie doke. Next one. Smoke under streetlights. Ancient exiles masquerade. Whispers of a beast.
Wolf Among Us.
Correct.
Nice. Oh. Feels good to win.
2 points. All right.
Are they really ancient though?
This one.
They're like fairy tales, so. Mm.
Cool. This one might be a bit easy, but we'll see.
Challenge.
Objection.
Objection.
Bring our rules lawyer in here.
Bottomless chasm. Fallen leaves drift past mushrooms. Foes crushed from above.
Mario.
Yeah, I was going to say that, but then you,
you didn't raise your hand.
Without raising your hand.
We haven't raised our hand.
We have been. Yet. All of us have. Yes.
Oh, God. I'll take 1 point then.
Okay. 1 point.
You got to do the hand.
All right.
So if we just shout it out, we get 1 point? That's the new precedent?
Sure.
No. It should be. You just raise your hand.
And then, like, after someone shouts and they get it right, the person raises their hand is like, yeah, I was going to say that.
This is a table of non-competitive people.
Yes. Very, very much so. All right, next. World torn asunder. Crazed enemy from beyond. Drums of war rattle. Yeah.
Final Fantasy 3 and or 6.
Not correct. Yes.
Warcraft.
Correct.
Got it.
Ah! Yeah, no, I was... Okay. Was it specifically Cataclysm?
It was actually Warcraft 1.
Okay, fair enough.
But they mentioned that sort of stuff in Cataclysm.
Yeah, sure. Any of the dark portals, etc., that would all work.
Yeah. Cool. All right, next one. Jealous kidnapper. Red feathers burst from backpack. Gleaming honeycombs. Yes.
Danger Kazoo.
Yeah, correct.
You got it.
I was going to guess that, like, free honeycomb game.
As soon as
they made in the Doom Engine. That remembers that? The honeycomb... Forget it.
Wait.
That honeycomb cereal, they had...
Doom game
that came with it, and I was going to say, wow, that was a great...
I caught the reference, but I'm old, too, okay. So...
Very nice. All right, now this will be the last one for the current round, and then the rules are going to change a little bit.
Oh.
So, dragons embodied, sinister plot emerges, rivals test their strength.
Legend of the Dragoon.
Yes.
Legend of the Dragoon?
Incorrect.
I'm going to go ahead and guess, but I'm not sure you've played this game. Blue Dragon?
Incorrect.
Okay. That actually
that's a great game, since though. I know I'm going to get it wrong. Skyrim.
Incorrect.
Sorry. Technically, what you said applies to Blue Dragon.
I and still Skyrim, and all the guesses for everything I said.
Can you read it again? They don't actually...
Dragons embodied. Sinister plot
he's
emerges.
He's a dragon embodied?
Emerges.
He's dragonborn.
Rivals test their strength.
I got nothing. I'm going to feel so horrible when I've played the game.
So you're going to pass?
Yeah.
Street Fighter.
I was going to guess that. Ah.
Dragon Punch and all that stuff. Hadouken is...
Oh, that's too metaphorical.
That's metaphorical with other stuff.
Rules layer. Rules layer.
All right. Moving on to the final round. These are going to be five haiku. What we're going to do this time is I'm going to read one line at a time. And if you can guess it on the first line, there's no negative points here. Guess on the first line, you get 3 points. Guess on the second, you get 2. Guess on the third, you get 1.
You're going to read the whole thing anyway, right?
I'm doing one line at a time, so I'm going to like read a line, pause.
Right. But once we get it, you're still going to finish it, right?
Sure.
We're not going to be left just hanging.
Oh, yeah, no, no. I'll definitely read it. Half
you have to spend points to get him to read the rest.
Yeah, there you go. That's like a DLC or something.
That's how you tell if you're a true narrative gamer.
That's right.
There you go. All right. First time in the sun. Dust, rubble, and empty streets.
Fallout.
Correct.
Oh.
So the whole haiku. First time in the sun, dust, rubble, and empty streets, alone with a dog.
Wow.
Yep. I actually had it on the first line. I should have guessed.
Mm.
So it's 2 points for the second line?
2 points for the second line.
Okay.
Correct. Okie doke. Next one. Distant sirens wail. World blurs past unblinking eyes. Pedal pressed to floor. Yes, Jim.
Need for Speed?
Correct.
I was going to guess GTA because of the sirens.
Mm.
That's why you don't guess too early.
Yeah.
Okay. Next one. Splinters and Knuckles. I saw Jim first.
Oh, I wasn't sure. Okay. I actually don't have a guess. Wait, I'll just say...
You can pass if you don't want to guess because Will had a guess too.
Okay. I'll just say Mortal Kombat.
Incorrect.
Yeah.
I'm going to go on the pun and say Ninja Turtles.
Incorrect.
I knew you were going to guess the pun. I knew it. I knew it was coming.
All right, second line. Empire built with blood and sweat. A subtle hissing.
Oh, is it Minecraft?
It is Minecraft.
I'm out. I'm done.
So the whole haiku again.
What's the matter?
Splinters and Knuckles. Empire built with blood and sweat. A subtle hissing.
Splinters and beating up the trees. Yeah, mm-hmm. Got it.
I'm actually kind of proud of that one because it had the whole like reversal with the last line, the haiku thing going.
Very
so
nice.
Thank you. All right, next one. Air is thick with lead. A battle between outlaws. Spoils to the victor. Jim.
Red Dead Redemption?
Incorrect.
Oh, I'm glad I didn't guess that.
Yeah, I was going to guess it too.
I'll read it again.
We don't get no negative points in this round.
So that's true, correct. Yeah.
So reading again for 1 point, if you can guess that based on the whole IQ. Air is thick with lead. A battle between outlaws. Spoils to the victor. Jim, Richard.
Call of Juarez?
No, although I can see why you guessed that.
Yeah.
Same with Red Dead Redemption, actually. Passes?
Can you read it one more time?
Okay. Air is thick with lead. A battle between outlaws. Spoils to the victor.
It's gotta be PvP. Something.
I have no clue. Between outlaws.
No guesses?
Quake.
No, sorry.
Chex Quest.
No. Borderlands.
I just wanted to say Chex Quest.
Minesweeper.
No, it was Borderlands.
Borderlands?
Spoils, loot.
Ah, sure.
That makes sense.
And
they're outlaws.
Yeah,
okay.
So, it's bandit shooting bandits, essentially.
In other words, the most recent shooter that I've played. Yeah.
Well, there you go.
Good. That was
all right, this is the final haiku.
I think Jim and I are tied right now, aren't we?
I have 17 points.
Oh, wow. Well, all right, I guess. Never mind.
I've just been giving myself tick marks, you know, for the last 5 minutes.
I still have -1, so.
Oh, well.
Okey-doke. Inadequate fence.
Age of Empires.
Incorrect. Unexpected explosion. A lick from behind.
Hey, whoa.
Wait a minute.
It's still PG, don't worry.
Oh.
A lick to the behind? Is that the last?
From,
that's
not a, from behind.
Oh.
So.
Because that would not be a haiku if it was. I was pointing that out.
Yeah, it wouldn't be. You're correct.
Inadequate fence.
All right, so again, inadequate fence, unexpected explosion, a lick from behind. This one's recent. I'll give you that.
Hint. Crazy taxi.
Jim.
I have a guess.
Mm-hmm.
Thief.
Incorrect.
Ah.
Richard's face right now.
I know. Inadequate fence?
Yeah.
Anybody want to take any more guesses?
That's why I said Age of Empires. If there's a hole in your fence, you lose.
I thought it was fence, like you steal something and sell it back.
That's
what I was going to do.
Yeah.
No, literal fence.
And then there was an explosion in the newest one early on.
Mm.
And then he got attacked. He attacks people from behind. He licks them from behind. So it
tends. Oh, I see what you're saying. Yeah.
Oh!
Yes.
Clash of Clans.
No. Sorry. Any more guesses?
Mm.
The name escapes me, but is it that that currently unreleased indie game that's a roguelike where you're playing as spies?
No, I'm sorry.
Okay. I can't remember the name of it.
What?
The game is Goat Simulator.
What?
Oh!
This is supposed to be about games. It's not a game.
Ever popular.
Not a game debate to think for another night.
No, it's no debate. They called it Goat Simulator.
Yeah, not the goat game.
So simulators can't be games?
Yeah, of course not. That's their
different. Or Goat Quest.
Could have been. See, if it was Goat Quest, then I'd be like, okay. Okay.
But what about the X? I'm not going to start this.
Link from
which
behind.
One?
The X-Men games. They're all classed as space combat sims. They're all simulators.
Well, a sim is a type of game genre, but they're not called a simulator. They're just called a sim.
But the simulator has quests.
Yeah.
So
this one is the Goat Simulator. Literally, it's supposed to be simming your life as a goat.
Yeah.
All right. So what was everyone's scores?
Four.
There's no negative points on that last one, right?
Correct.
Okay, then negative one.
Negative one.
So I win, right?
So
it was a three-way tie.
A three-way tie for 4 points.
Do you have a tiebreaker? I think you should make them make up.
See, if I had said Strider that time, I would have won, so we'll just say that I won.
So tiebreaker. Everyone, you've got like a few seconds to freestyle a haiku. Whichever one I like best wins.
You gonna give him a game to target?
Okay, yeah, let's
No. We should just all do a separate
one. Just come up with a haiku?
You want me to do one too?
Sure, just for fun.
Oh, okay.
You're not in contention, but you can do one for fun.
Right.
Fill this empty space with Jeopardy music.
Backward compatible.
Will is done.
Yep. I practice these at work when I have nothing else to do.
Oh, wow. Nice.
Okay. I guess we'll start with Doc, since you're not competing for the win.
Okay. This has nothing to do with a specific game.
Okay.
It is merely gaming.
Mm-hmm.
And my own personal philosophy bleeding through here.
Okay.
Make them pay with life. I want to kill them all now. I like to GM.
So we're not playing Star Wars RPG.
After that, I'm not so sure it's a good idea. All right, so it's coming down to Will and Richard.
I'm working on one.
Jim's working on one. So we'll start with Will.
Behold my army. Hexes on all of my units. Oh, curse you, Gandhi.
Civilization.
Yeah.
I like it.
Very nice.
Very nice.
Gandhi. Curse you, Gandhi.
All right, what you got, Richard?
Wub, 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 wub. Handsome Jack is a dickhead. Wub, 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 wub.
Borderlands 2?
Yep.
Yes!
I know that was a difficult one.
I like the comment with the wub wubs, but...
Is he disqualified since that wasn't original?
Technically, he did adapt the line.
Well, it's
so, we'll leave it in contention. All right, you got one, Jim?
Yes.
Cool, what you got?
Seared to perfection. Mixing and baking with love. Hot off the griddle.
What are you
doing? You got it!
Cool.
Okay,
all
right. Guys. So, I enjoyed all of your haikus. We're all winners here, but I still got to pick one. Richard, unfortunately, all the wubs, funny, weren't... truly creative.
You just don't like dubstep, man.
I do like dubstep.
Obviously
actually.
A hater.
Obviously a hater.
I'll go on record saying I'm a hater of dubstep. I'm on record now.
All right. So it comes down between you two. I'm more partial, I think, to Civ, and I like the Gandhi thing, so I'm going to go and give it to Will.
Yay!
Yeah.
You say Will yours one more time.
Behold my army, hexes on all of my units. Oh, curse you, Gandhi.
There you go.
I do hate Gandhi instead.
Cool.
He's not a pacifist.
I've never had a problem with him, but I never got through a game with him.
I'm pretty sure that was actually the result of like a bug in the first game. They thought it was funny enough that they decided to keep it. The whole idea that as soon as you hit the atomic age,
Gandhi nukes you.
Yeah. So he's super peaceful the whole game, and then he just goes super aggressive.
I've never played a game of Civ, but that is the one thing that I know and I hear from everybody is that Gandhi is a nuclear activist.
Cool. All right, so that was our game.
Rigged.
So we're going to go and move into our main meaty discussion for the evening.
Meaty.
Yes, and so the reason we're all gathered here tonight actually is for a role-playing session. We just finished our Age of Rebellion, or we're starting Age of Rebellion. We just finished Edge of the Empire last week.
The Star Wars RPG.
Yeah, and we actually talked about that on our last week's podcast as well, about how we wrapped up that campaign.
I'm actually LARPing as a Bothan right now.
It's a
great costume, by the way. I love
That's
it.
Why. Oh, okay.
I thought something was off. I
thought it was just like the latest fashion trend.
I'm just extra hairy today.
I thought that the hospital had hired you out as the safety bear again.
Safety bear?
Yeah.
Yeah. So Doc and Will are here with us because they are part of our regular role-playing group. So Doc's been our game master, our GM. And Will is just the
emotional
guy with
punching bag.
Yes, the that and the guy with the strangely encyclopedic knowledge of Star Wars, which is actually quite helpful most of the time. So.
Yeah, it's
it's pretty much Will. Would this work? Well, consulting my vast knowledge of the Star Wars universe, that won't work. But here's about three different alternatives that could.
Yep.
In narrative terms, I'm actually really glad to have him here because he's my foil. He brings my nerd level way down, and so makes me look normal. Actually, I choose my friends very carefully based on that.
Based on that, yeah.
It's just like Big Bang Theory. If you think about that show, narratively, that you know, the show's obviously about Leonard, but you know, all of his friends are dysfunctional in a way that makes him look normal.
Anyway, so the actual meaty discussion, not Big Bang Theory, is we're going to talk about. Essentially interactive narrative across a bunch of different mediums. And so since we're here for our role-playing night, we want to talk about, you know, and sort of leading in from last week's discussion, about the differences in storytelling and mediation of story that come from analog RPGs to video games. We can even bring in other forms of media, you know, just to see what happens with different, you know, modalities of narrative. So we'll go ahead and start off, I think, with the RPG, since that's sort of what we're all familiar with. I think each of us has GM'd pretty extensively. Jim, you're the only one I'm not sure.
No, I have. Yeah.
Okay. So in that case, why don't we start with the narrative that we're going through right now? And Adam, could you sort of shed some light on how you might have had to react to us in game, how you've had to spin things? Have you had a... I know that for our first session, the last one that we just finished up, The Jewel of Yavin, one that Chris actually wrote a little article on, that was a pre-made campaign out of a book.
Yeah.
But I'm sure that there are many things that you changed up, adapted.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
So well, actually, that was one of the very first pre-made campaigns I've ever run. Like, ever.
Yeah.
One of my favorite systems is Burning Wheel and all the Luke Crane stuff. And so, you know, Burning Empires and even Mouse Guard.
Mouse Guard's pretty great.
Yeah.
That is pretty awesome.
They're fun systems. And but the thing is, you don't have any pre-made scenarios for those. So I usually run them in the Lord of the Rings universe. So there's this huge pantheon of lore. Well, Star Wars has a huge amount of lore, and it's on its, gosh... Don't hold me to this, but like third or fourth version of the system now. Not this system, but a system.
Yeah.
It's been a D20. It's been a D6. It's you name it. It's been it. And some of those systems I don't even know. I haven't even looked at or played.
Right? Am I right on that? Just third?
I'm really new to role playing games. Actually, I've only been playing them for a few years.
I think they just had a D6 and a D20, or is that?
Well, there was more than one version of the D20 though.
Yeah. There's D6, D20, and then D20 Modern.
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay.
And that was like supposed to be Saga Edition, and the books are square. It's very strange. Like literally, geometrically square. No,
right.
Not making commentary.
Just
square. But the new system is fantastic because it's got the proprietary dice. It has narrative systems built into it. But one of the things that I really liked about these scenarios that they're coming out with right now is that they're not they don't necessarily feel like shoot 'em ups. And the cool thing about the Juliavin, I think you mentioned this in your article, actually, was that it was a heist.
Mm-hmm.
I think you guys fired like one shot. And it was yourself.
I fired multiple shots, but only one of them actually.
Well, fair enough.
Yeah.
But you got through everything narratively, and you literally talked your way, negotiated your way out of trouble, and that sort of a thing. And so for this group, that was fantastic. Mm-hmm. I'm really looking forward to the next series of adventures, because I'm going to challenge you to come out of your shells within your characters.
Because we're fighting a war now.
And yeah, because you guys have decided to join up the rebellion. And mm-hmm. so, yeah, you got to take this seriously now. This is not fun and games. This is not stealing gems. This mm-hmm. is serious stuff. The fate of the galaxy is in your hands.
Mm-hmm.
But there were some things that I had to change. For example, two of you had played with me before in another group, and you carried your characters over.
Yeah, that was me and Jim.
Right. That was the hook, actually, is that the person that you knew from that, his name was Cal Alson, and that was from a different scenario. I just brought him into the scenario, and he wasn't a part of it.
Right.
By the end of it, I actually had him defect and become a member of the Rebels himself, and it's quite possible you could run into him in this next set, too, and I assure you, he's not in any of these books either.
Sure.
At one point, one of my favorite moments was whenever our elite hacker, Liska, the Bothan,
who I am currently LARPing as.
Yes. needed basically some equipment for hacking and for doing all kinds of cool stuff. And so I thought, you know what? He's really tooled out, but the one thing he doesn't have is a very awesome gold-plated droid who happens to be an R5 unit with a vocoder. And so we made that happen.
And a sassy attitude.
Sassy attitude.
For the man who has everything.
Yeah.
The Bothan.
And of course, it was a great opportunity for me to make it questionable as to his loyalty, but then he ended up being true and golden, pun intended. So, but that's a character that wasn't in the scenario. I just made him up when I needed to pull him out. And so I'm really enjoying this the system, because one of the things you can do is you can consider threes to be average. Mm. And so since threes are average, if you need a character, you can make one up on the spot.
Right.
I needed to create a new NPC. I don't have to pretend to go to the bathroom and take my pencil with me and you know, roll up a character real fast. I can actually just pull one out and go, this is the stat that makes sense for him, pencil it in, and then as I need it, I can create new characters.
Yeah, so, that's a great thing about analog RPGs, is the ability to, you know, come up with characters on the fly. And, you know, honestly, half the times we encounter a new NPC, we don't even ask you their name. You know, and if we do, you just probably like have to pull up a random NPC name. Mm-hmm. You know, this is NPC 47, you know, whereas in like video games, everything comes hard coded. You know, no matter how many instances of branching dialogue there are, or how many NPCs there are in the world, even something like Planescape Torment, which had like, you know, 10 dialogue options per conversation, you know, sometimes more, mm-hmm. even that is the same every time. Like, you can still pick the same choices and you'll see the same stuff every time.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and while of course, you know, every person's experience is going to be unique because they, you know, click on different spots and they, you know, battles might go differently. The dice rolling systems in the game, the random number generators might spin the other way. But there's no real, at least right now, procedurality to video games. Whereas in an RPG, you can come up with a new character on the spot. You know, previously we've talked about how fun it is to barter with a GM, especially like, I know Will, you're pretty notorious for being a munchkin, which for those who are unfamiliar, a munchkin is somebody who min-maxes the hell out of a system.
Well, I don't know. He's not really a munchkin in the traditional sense. He's more a munchkin in kind of the narrative sense.
I guess.
That's because I can't trust the dice, man. I have to find the
you
best
are
way to do
genuinely
this.
The worst roller I've ever met.
Not the past two, three weeks, but yes.
Yeah.
Yeah, he gave me his bad juju the last couple times we played.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, he has.
Oh, did you beat him in like a
everything.
Game? Everything. Yeah. Oh, beat him
last
everything.
Last weekend, I won every game, and we played three rounds of, what was that, Avalon?
Yeah.
Yeah. Mm. played three rounds of Avalon and won all three.
Nice.
So. He beat me in the Star Wars minis, the X-Wing minis.
Oh, well, Avalon's diceless, so I guess that doesn't
right,
really count.
But it's based on like multiple people, and you keep changing sides.
So. Oh, true, yeah.
The thing is, I won all of these games.
I want to disagree with one thing you just said. I would not define a munchkin as a min-maxer, necessarily. I think those are two separate things.
Okay.
A munchkin is somebody who abides by the rules. And they might be a min-maxer. I mean, that's one way to munchkin. But I think anybody who abuses the rules and finds the loopholes, I think loopholes are the key. And so, yeah, min-maxing might be one way. But I think you can actually min-max, and I'm going to sound like a min-maxer saying this, but I think some of the most interesting characters can be min-maxers.
Sure.
For example, your character, Liska, that we were talking about, one of the most interesting things about that scenario is whenever you had to fire shots and couldn't.
Yeah.
And I thought that was great. Mm-hmm. And so, of course,
that's very true. Yeah,
I made sure to give you a couple of security droids that weren't originally in the scenario.
Yeah,
so that you would be challenged by that.
You jerk.
And you intentionally described them as like rusty, old, outdated models, just so I'd feel even worse when I couldn't be
fired. Exactly.
But no, I totally agree. So essentially, Munchkin is like a min-maxer taken to the next level. They find the holes and break the system and things like that.
Yeah, I mean, all apples are fruit, but not all fruit are apples.
Sure, fair enough.
So that's how I would classify. The other thing that I would point out, I agree with everything you said. In fact, I've made kind of that same speech myself in classes before. But I will make one proviso, and it's games like Fallout. Mm-hmm. That use the special system, which is literally just a straight down the row RPG system.
Yep.
It rolls for everything. So if your stats are actually too low to communicate, you will see dialogue options like duh and grunt and ugh.
Yeah.
Which is fantastic.
Cool. They had to add that back in when they did New Vegas because they didn't really have that Fallout 3.
They also had that, I think, in Neverwinter Nights.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Neverwinter
Nights is the D&D system. Yeah.
So, and then there's other options in there where you can try to say something, but you'll actually fail at it. And then if you reload the game at that same point, you say the exact same thing, it re-rolls it, and you might actually succeed that time.
Interesting.
Which is interesting.
So it's not just straight up skill gating, because I think I remember in New Vegas where it would tell you you need like engineering 30 to be able to unlock this dialogue.
Right, yeah, you have to have a certain amount of skill at a certain level.
Yeah, I think what they did actually was if your skill wasn't at a certain level, it literally was impossible to succeed on the roll. So they were just letting you know that it was impossible for you to even try. Mm-hmm. But if you had up to that level, it still didn't mean you'd succeed.
Yeah, sure. There are definitely random elements to be had in games. It's the same thing as, like, say you're playing Skyrim, you can choose the same dialogue options every time, but this case, when you entered this battle, they could crit you, or, you know, something, they could generate a couple of extra enemies behind you that weren't there before. And so there are certain random elements that can definitely create new experiences, but in terms of just the narrative, things like that are pretty few and far between. Speaking of, like, the random dialogue system and things like that. Typically, we find things in video games to be, unfortunately, the Paragon Renegade system in Mass Effect.
Not only
is it binary, but they directly place the good option is up top, bad one is below.
That was something, and I think I might have mentioned this on another podcast, I know I've talked about before, just in general. The first time I played Mass Effect 2, which was the first one I played, I actually didn't know it was Paragon up top, Renegade on the bottom. So I went through the game the first time actually just sort of picking what I was interested in picking. And it made it a whole lot more interesting. And then when I figured out it was Paragon top, Renegade bottom, it like removed all the magic for me.
Yeah.
And that's why I kind of miss like the style they had with Dragon Age Origins and, you know, KOTOR and stuff like that, where it was just a list of options. You didn't really know which one was good, which one's bad. You just had to kind of go with what I'm thinking, what I'm feeling is right.
Yeah, I think, I know, for example, in some of the earlier games, like Baldur's Gate, Planescape Torment especially is really good on this, is they don't have just the good option, the bad option. They have multiple gradations between, and sometimes you can say the same option, but you're intentionally lying, or intentionally, maybe you're telling the truth about doing something bad, or you're lying about doing something bad, or vice versa.
Right.
And it adds a lot more to it than just, is it good or is it bad? That's why one of the things I liked about New Vegas that they kind of brought back that Fallout 3 never really had, because Fallout 3, they just basically threw in the same Skyrim system, everything was either good or bad. It didn't really have that sort of gray area, which is what the Fallout universe has always been about. In New Vegas, they with having the whole faction system, you could be seen as being a hero through the eyes of one faction, right. But you're a villain through the eyes of another faction. So mm-hmm. there's not just you're good or bad throughout the world. There's a bigger...
Yeah, you have to pick sides, essentially. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Now, I'm curious, on those ones where they had lying is an option, did they have any sort of mechanic that said, you know, based on my, you know, say charisma or like, you know, deception skill, was there like a chance that they could call you on your lie? I forget if those games had that.
I think with Planescape Torment, it's been a while since I've played it, but I do think that you could tell someone something, and if you're trying to convince, like, you would, I think you wouldn't even get the option for some of the things. Like, if you didn't have a high enough skill in, I forgot which communication skill it was.
That's true.
You wouldn't even get the option. Okay. But if you did, you were able to try to, like, lie to them about certain options or certain things that you might say. Like, someone might say, here, I'll give you my ring or a bunch of money, and then you go deliver it to so-and-so, and you can say, yeah, sure, I'll do that, and you're lying, you just take it and never do it.
Yeah, and that's an example of a place where I wonder, too, if we even need to have the lie option as a dialogue choice, because then you can just say it and not do it.
No,
and
but
it's effectively a lie.
But it makes it more interesting, because if you're talking to someone and you were actually there, and you're trying to lie, you have to convince, like, if I'm telling you something and I'm lying.
Maybe if you're conscious of the lie when you're saying it,
exactly.
Can change weights.
Because it's different. It's different, right. if you say you're going to do it and you're just changing your mind.
That's a good
than
point.
If you're actually lying to them, especially since sometimes you can do things like, if you're trying to role play that you're a good person, but you're trying to act like you're not because you're trying to maintain this like roguish personality, you can lie about saying, like, I'm not going to help you, go to hell, but that's a lie, you're actually going to help them out. So, like, you had that option, too.
You know, that's honestly a really good example of some of the technical limitations of Nair. It's really interesting, because you would think as technology advances, the limitations would become less prevalent, but as video games have advanced, I'd say we've had more technical and gameplay possibilities, but less narrative possibilities.
It's voice acting.
Right.
I honestly think that the main problem is that there's been an obsession with game developers now to add voice acting, and that limits all of the choices that they can do and all the dialogue things. But they can't do as much dialogue because they now have to record voice
acting. Have you guys played Divinity Original Sin?
No,
I actually haven't.
So I haven't played very much of it at all, but there's sort of a moment of shame for me. It seemed to me immediately upon playing it that it was the new Planescape Torment. Playing through it, they have a ton of dialogue options. They have a lot of really great narrative mechanics. Like, if you have multiple people playing, it's a co-op online. And if you have multiple people playing, you can actually have branching dialogue where all of the characters get involved, and you can talk to each other's characters and things like that. And there was a couple of moments where, talking with NPCs, you'd see like a dozen dialogue options, similar to the old Planescape days. And yet this moment of shame for me is because I got bored because there was no voice acting. I got tired of like reading through all of this.
Really?
Now, granted, it's because I was playing with two people at the same time, and we wanted to get to the action.
Right,
we were playing together and things like that. We weren't really taking the time to experience the narrative.
I haven't played this game, so I don't know. It's possible that either what they were saying was just not as interesting. It's also possible that the world itself, the atmosphere, wasn't as engrossing, because one of the things that got you into it with Planescape Torment, first of all, there was some voice here and there. It was just a kind of bad flavor.
Yeah, there's
but
voice
was,
here and there.
Yeah,
well.
It was the sounds and the sort of music and the atmosphere sort of like drew you in with all of the different sounds where you felt like you were kind of in that world, so it was okay for you to sit there and read different dialogue choices because you kind of felt like you were listening to them anyway. If Divinity didn't have that same sort of great sound design, it may have still lost it.
It does.
I think I'm actually kind of with you there, Richard, though, because I'm kind of like one of those por que no los dos types of people. You know, I want to have tons and tons of options, but I also want to have the voice acting. Mm-hmm. Because having the voice there, I mean, it makes it, you know, more immersive, and sure, maybe there's some issues with like, oh, they said that in a way I didn't intend for it to sound. But I mean, that's just something that it doesn't happen often enough. That's really a problem. And so, like, I want sort of to have both because I find the voice acting to make things, you know, more engaging while you're playing.
It won't happen. Like, until we develop a system where we can have a very realistic, computerized voice that is reading off text as they type it in, that's still a ways off.
Actually, they have fully synthetic computerized voices that sound human, and that's actually what all a Vocaloid is. It's a program that they've used to generate completely synthetic characters that can sound that way.
I've heard stuff on that, though. It doesn't sound realistic.
Have you listened to any of the songs sung by Hatsune Miku?
Yes.
with all the ones that I have listened to that are outside of the game. They're actually their stage performances. She sounds normal.
Right, but that's because those were set up beforehand. They're not in live time. Not live time, but they're not reading off all of the different options.
Which is why what's missing is not so much the technology. What's missing is one specific component, which is procedural lying.
Yes.
All of Turing is basically the ability to lie. Right. And until machines are fully able to lie and construct something outside of just a full, here's a backlog of information I have, I can throw it at you because you said this. You can't produce anything. Once you've got that, you can have something read over and read over even just a script and generate a proper voice completely normally.
But then we're going to have the rise of the machines and Terminators coming.
That's a singularity.
No, let's not go that far.
They'll all be bards.
Never give
because
them bards.
Because the act of lying is the core mechanic of storytelling.
That's actually something that I really have appreciated in... digital narratives, what you just called them, bards. I've, for the past year and a half or so, been writing papers on games as digital bards, yeah. You know, and that's sort of the next step, I feel, is when you have that sort of procedurality to storytelling and you have the ability for them to decide to lie and things like that. It really is this sort of return to bardic tradition. But the issue that I'm having with games that are all just wall of text, you know, you're all, you read them dialogue mm-hmm. options. Now, this is coming from the guy who's played through every Final Fantasy multiple times, played through Planescape multiple times, Baldur's Gate, etc. I got bored playing these games. Well, that
the thing with Divinity too, I was going to ask you because you mentioned that, how long did they give you before they gave you another choice? Because that's another issue too. If it's you have to kind of balance out the paragraph and then giving you a choice of something to say, a couple of sentences, one sentence, or are they actually giving you like a big giant block of text and then expect you to read all of it and only after all of that giving you a choice?
No, it's...
It's the text equivalent of a cutscene.
It seems pretty well-paced. Like I said, I only played it for about an hour or two and I was playing it co-op over Vent, Ventrilo, you know, and so there was a lot of distracting elements there. So I definitely want and intend to give it a second try, but my first encounter with it was definitely, I don't want to take the time to read all this, you know? And yeah. That's the first time that I've ever openly felt that. Like, I mean, I'm sure that I've encountered that previously, like, oh, I don't want to read all this. Where's the action? But, you know, I'm a narrative guy. So that came as a shock to me when I realized that that's what I was feeling playing this game that's been pretty critically well received, you know? So I'm definitely going to give it another try. In fact, I'll probably write an article about it for our website.
Cool.
But at the same time, I feel like that might be some sort of like cultural shift that's happened, is this obsession with voiceovers has now even started to affect, you know, at least I'm speaking only for myself, but people like me.
Well, I was going to say, you know, do you feel that way when you're reading fiction? Because...
Okay, here's another shameful admission. I haven't read a fictional book for pleasure since January of last year.
Well, there you go.
Yeah.
That's more recently than some, I would imagine.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, that is. Yeah.
But, I mean, this is also coming from the guy who's read, like, 2,000 books in his lifetime. Oh, okay. College has really gotten in the way.
Yeah, would you get married recently or something?
Yeah.
Divinity, what's the world in that? Is it... I assume it's a fantasy game?
Yeah, it's a fantasy game, and you essentially think of it as, you know, your typical medieval fantasy setting. You arrive on a ship at this desolate isle, and you're... I can't remember exactly what it is, but you're like a... You hunt down renegade sorcerers, and it's pretty interesting. The premise seemed cool, but you encounter a shipwreck and you get to this town that's like a port city, and you're immediately thrust into like this political turmoil with like assassinations going on at the same time as you're trying to solve. I think, you know, now that I'm speaking it out loud, I think the issue that I had was just that there were so many different storylines going on at the same time, and because I was so rushed doing it, because it was in a co-op setting, I didn't really have time to process it all.
Oh, okay. So it's just, they were just throwing a bunch of information at you.
Yeah, because now that I'm thinking about it, they immediately introduced via cutscene at the beginning of the game, you're like hunting down these sorcerers. Oh, you're here at this isle where there's like a zombie plague that's going on. The dead are walking the streets. Oh, you're walking through this first intro zone. There's some sorcerers running past with another plot line.
oh, you just got to this city, there's a burning ship and orcs are here. Oh, you just got through this city, now you're in a portal in another world. Like, there's a lot of different plot lines that are just thrust at you right away.
I think you just sort of made a point, too, that sort of explains something for me. You know, I think you mentioned, Jim, that in Planescape Torment, you kind of don't mind all the reading because it's a single player game and you're kind of immersed in the story. But you know, you're talking about multiplayer, and I remember when we were all playing WildStar online, I wasn't reading anything because we were all concerned about, like, you know, where is this person? What are we doing? What quest are we on?
Well, that explains why you were leaving me behind.
Yeah, exactly.
I was reading everything.
So that's why you guys are so slow. Like, but
well, it's either single player. It's it's essentially an isometric action game, you know, in the same vein of Planescape.
So it's not an MMO.
No, it's turn-based, actually.
But I think that what VoiceOver does for you is it's good for multitasking, because your eyes can be doing something else while your ears and your brain are just processing what's being said. So I thought that, you know, for instance, co-op story in Star Wars The Old Republic actually worked really well because it was voiced over. Everyone's sort of stopping to listen, unless everyone's just mashing the space bar, in which case you don't have to worry about falling behind.
Right.
We ran into the same thing with the Tales of series. We played through Zillia, and everyone enjoyed it a lot, but it's almost all voice acted. We went back and played Tales of Symphonia, because the other guys I was with had never played it, and by the end of it, we lost one guy, and then the other guy was really starting to drag on it, and I think part of it was the fact that whenever we would get to people talking, it's all text.
You enjoyed Tales of Zillia?
I enjoyed playing with other people. I think Vesperia is better.
See...
than Zillia by a lot.
I was going to say, Will, what you're supposed to do when you have the text is you pick someone to read off the text. And then that's the fun. And it's like someone is playing and he seems like he's not interested. You just go, okay, you're reading this character.
Or I'm never allowed to be first player in the Tales of games, for example, because I read too quickly. And so I'll wait a couple of seconds and think that I've waited long enough and hit X.
And so then
my buddy Dan will turn around and be like, Richard, what the
The problem that I have with that is that they don't read the name. So one person will start reading and he'll just glaze over into everyone else's lines.
Oh, okay.
And suddenly it's the same voice for everyone and you lose track of what's going on.
Mm.
Mm. Well, just don't play with illiterates and then you won't have that problem.
Oh, wow. Wow.
So,
I'm kidding. That just...
I have no retort.
So returning to a second to tabletop role-playing games, a topic that I've been kind of interested in is, you know, we've talked about how video games have to be sort of pre-written, pre-planned. Even when you're giving the player choice, you're sort of giving them limited numbers of choices based on what you sort of think the most likely or most appropriate choices would be. Whereas in role-playing games, it gets totally open-ended. And so it's interesting that we get railroaded a lot in games and, you know, at worst we call them, too linear, that sort of thing. But if you have any sort of railroading in a tabletop game, it's like a cardinal sin of GMing. You're never supposed to railroad or else everyone just hates you for it. So,
you know, that's... You can if you hide it right.
Yeah, that's what... Okay, so that's one of the things that I'm glad you brought up, because, you know, a lot of people, when they think of, like, what makes certain media better than another, it's often, you know, the capability of that media,
right,
or medium. And so we're talking about, like, say, films are always going to be linear, so people say. But then you've got things like Memento, and you've got, you know, I had this really interesting presentation that I watched while I was in Portugal, and it was this woman said that films that make you uncomfortable, that they agitate the viewer, that they become inherently non-linear and they give you a greater sense of agency because they've got you into this state of unrest that has your mind working really hard and things like that.
Yeah.
And then you have in video games, which people like to tout that games are the most non-linear and you can have sandboxes and things like that. But some of the most popular and most critically well-received games are like Mass Effect and The Last of Us. The Last of Us is just an interactive film, really. It's like a generic third-person shooter that you click through cutscenes. You know, so I really get confused when people start talking about interactive as this really amazing thing in games, and you know. Well, yeah, the biggest and most well-received games are just interactive cinema.
You have to be careful saying when people say this and people say that, because you're kind of making the assumption that it's the same on both sides.
Right, yeah, that is definitely a sweeping generalization.
A lot of those that are, they might be, those games like Mass Effect, Last of Us, might be very popular, but they're not necessarily popular with the same crowd that touts interactivity as such a big thing for games.
And there's also, for sure, there's also a difference.
I would argue that it's not.
I absolutely agree.
So I think that there's definitely the public, at least the general casual public that is playing games. Sorry. Is that a bad dirty word?
Did you just throw out casual?
I'm throwing people under the bus. I do think that a lot of people that play games are not necessarily interested in that much of an interactive experience. They might just want to play through, have a little bit of interactivity through a story that they find interesting. I think there's a lot of people that are going for that, and there's other people that are going for the exact opposite, that want to have as much of an open sandbox to play around in and don't even care about the narrative. And there's people that are, you know, all levels in between.
Sure. It also depends on both, though. I mean, is it possible to do both?
What do you mean?
I'll throw out an example here. Watch Dogs. Just played, I don't know, maybe an hour of Watch Dogs because my dad had, and he brought it, and, you know, I plugged it in and that sort of thing. In the first 5 minutes, there's this thing where it says, shoot this guy. Yeah. And you have no choice. You have to shoot him. It's part of the tutorial.
God, that made me so mad.
Of, you know, well, I shot him in the leg is what I did. And it didn't matter. It didn't matter that I shot him in the leg.
I actually chose not to do anything. I sat there and didn't do anything at all. And the game wouldn't progress.
Right.
And so I shot. And then it goes into the cutscene afterwards where it's like, now hit F in this quick time, you know, event.
Mm-hmm.
And then I said, I'm not going to do it. I'm just going to sit here. And the game slows down and doesn't do anything for a while. And I was like, is it going to halt again? And then no, he just beats the crap out of him anyway. Yeah. The game essentially says, I don't care if you're going to hit the button or not. This is what's going to happen.
That's right.
So you're
playing Aiden Cross. You're not playing you as Aiden Cross.
Yeah.
And yeah.
That made me really
mad.
So
I guess my point is, we talked about Mass Effect. I think it was Mass Effect 3 had an option where you could just turn off the dialogue completely and just play it as an action game.
Really? I had no idea.
There is a thing. Yeah, essentially you can have it do automatic responses, and so it sort of picks the default Shepard, whatever that happens to be, and so when it comes to dialogue choice, it doesn't even show you, it just has Shepard say something.
Yeah.
Does it randomly choose if it's going to be a good, a bad, a neutral Shepard?
I think my guess would be they sort of pick a path for you. And so there's kind of a path they have in mind, so if you came into, like, say, Mass Effect 2 without playing 1, whatever the automatic Shepard for 1 was what happened when you start 2.
That's really interesting.
I think you may be giving them too much credit, but...
Maybe?
Yeah. It was the same thing for Tor, for Old Republic. Mm-hmm. Actually, you could turn off the dialogue entirely.
That makes sense, because from what I've been told by a bunch of people is that Knights of the Old Republic was essentially the prototype for Mass Effect. They, from what I heard, they made that game just to... Really? Mass Effect was the prototype for KOTOR?
Depends on which aspect you're talking about, really. But you're right. That game... I mean, back in 2009, I watched footage of Tor, and I got so excited.
Now, you know, I'm not talking about the MMO.
Oh, I am.
Oh, no. So, Knights of the Old Republic, the games, there's the 1 and 2.
Right. Okay, yes. Those were the prototypes.
Okay, that's okay.
You're right.
See, for me, I really enjoyed Knights of the Old Republic, the first two. I enjoyed the second one a lot, too, even though I know the ending, there was issues. I didn't like Mass Effect that much, honestly. Yeah. Like, I know it was very popular. I didn't like it. One of the reasons I didn't like it was because I felt... The first one was okay, but after the first one, it sort of shifted the focus away from the way that the story was being told to be a bit more action-y.
Yeah.
Plus, I felt that... And this is something I've been having trouble with Bioware for a while. They... are really getting involved in the whole, like, relationship angle, and I should put quotes around that.
Yeah.
It's not really relationship, it's trying to bed everyone around you.
Right.
And you didn't really get that impression. Like, in KOTOR, for example, I don't remember that even existing.
Well,
I
no,
guess
because
maybe it was there somewhere.
Bastila, the main female character in KOTOR, was, like, a hard-ass, independent woman, you know, the snap, 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 etc. You know, that was really great and really well handled. In Mass Effect, they really did make it, like, you know, all right, which character are you going to have the sex scene with? You know, and then in Dragon Age, it's like, you know, it was a really big focus in Dragon Age, I felt, especially...
That's what annoyed me with Dragon Age.
Especially with the female-female relationships, because they were, like, catering, it felt like, to, like, what they thought was the largely male gamer base.
I think it was more what they're trying to do. I mean, I think is that they're just trying to get as much attention as they can to try to push their games, like you know, media attention. Because that's like, it's basically the old adage of like, any press is good press, and they just want as much attention as they can, because I've heard that they're having trouble in terms of like money, like, you
know. Well, they certainly impressed Fox, so, but that's low.
Yeah, well, that's one, but I'm just saying, you know, you don't get that when
so was that
you
comment
make, you make
hey, I liked Ass Effect, I thought it was a great game.
Ass Effect,
what'd I say?
Yeah. It does kind of annoy me, because I know that some people will argue that they've been doing, BioWare's been, has somewhat of a history with the whole relationship thing. Like, I know back in Baldur's Gate, they did have that angle, especially Baldur's Gate 2, but it was a lot more subdued, and it was actually focused on the relationship aspect, not you can just be with anyone, bet anyone, and it doesn't... Yeah.
You know, I'm going to go ahead and go out on a limb here and link this back to analog RPGs, that I think that the types of relationships lend themselves better to certain media. And so, for example, with the sexual relationships, mm-hmm. you almost always see those in largely cinematic media, especially films.
Yeah.
The large majority of films, I would say, have some sort of sex scene in them.
At least implied.
Right. Yeah. Whereas in tabletop RPGs, for example, it's... I've never played an RPG where any character was sexually attracted to another character, and it's always been the sort of either mentorship relationship, guardianship relationship, something like that.
Apparently you're playing with the right people.
Yeah.
But so I think that...
Yeah, I would
I'm sure you have, you know, some tabletop gamers that want to seduce the bar wench.
I've GM'd those games.
So. Sure, that's fine. But those are more like one-off moments, I would say, yeah. And they're definitely not like some sort of
in inherent element.
And, yeah. And usually more done for comedy.
Sure,
tabletop. It's done because you all think it's funny if like the one guy tries to seduce the barmaid.
Mm-hmm. And thus, with like the sort of interactive media, I think the more successful relationships that people actually care about are those not just sexual relationships, like, you know, like protecting Ashley in Resident Evil, the president's daughter, or being Joel as the surrogate father for Ellie in The Last of Us. You know, you have those.
Or Lee in Walking
or
Dead.
Or Lee and Clementine. Yeah, yeah. You have these very mechanical relationships rather than like sexually gratifying relationships.
Mm-hmm. I wanted to sort of go quickly back to that one thought we had about, you know, we mentioned covering up the railroading that happens in tabletop role-playing games. And since we've all sort of GM'd, I'm curious to get everyone's thoughts on how exactly you go about having sort of a plot in mind, or especially if you're running an adventure module where pretty much you have beginning and an end that's set. How do you make it seem like you're not railroading the players?
Mm-hmm. Give them a choice, and then whichever choice they make, have them have the encounter anyway. The illusion of choices is powerful as choice.
Yeah, that's something they use in video games a lot.
Like, lead them back to the same...
Yeah, but it fails in video games because you can always reload and discover the trick.
All right.
But in a tabletop game, unless the GM just happens to be, say, interviewing for a podcast, they're not going to give their tricks. They're not going to give away what they're doing.
I think that's a really great thing to mention, because in games, especially in episodic games, we just played through The Wolf Among Us for an article, and one of the problems we had was that the choices and the illusion of choice was extremely well covered up during a playthrough, but once we talked to each other, and then if we ever did like a second playthrough, it became immediately obvious and the illusion was dispelled, etc. And then when we saw the flowchart that came out for The Walking Dead's first season, it was all just bottlenecks. The flowchart was just like a straight line, you know? And so that's something that works well the first time through, but is dispelled upon seeing it again. Whereas in RPGs, I don't really think that's the case.
It's funny to me, because people mention those branching story paths, and the only thing I can ever remember is Wing Commander. In Wing Commander 2, you have two branching story paths based on how you play the missions and how you interact with the crew. Mm-hmm. And if you do either of them poorly, it messes up the game later on down the line. Mm-hmm. If you play poorly, you lose. If you deal with your crew poorly, you lose.
Okay.
Even if you finish the game, you might lose extra crew.
I think that's the best way to integrate, you know, narrative decision is have it have gameplay ramifications.
Yeah,
and I don't think enough games do that.
Yeah. As opposed to just causing you to fail immediately. And now
for so many of them, it'd be so easy to do. I think the issue is that they don't want... I think people would cry foul, and I think wrongly, players would cry foul for a game failing them because they made the wrong dialogue option.
Right.
I think that if you're going to have dialogue options as part of the game, you kind of need it to actually matter somehow.
Well, but it wouldn't be failing. The trick is, you don't have them fail per se as in a game over. Mm. You let them keep playing, and then at the very end, their final experience is different. It changes.
Mm. That's what Wing Commander did.
Right. Like Will's example.
If you fail a mission... Mm. you don't stop playing unless you die. The mission keeps,
right, yeah,
the game keeps going.
Yeah.
If you fail a conversation, the game keeps going.
Right. There's a fundamental problem to this, though.
Mm.
And we all need to stop for just a second long enough to recognize it. I'm not saying that we need to not do this, but we need to recognize the problem. And it's this. In the same sense, metaphorically, that everyone screams over DLC that has extra content, mm-hmm, whereas DLC that changes the color of your clothes is okay,
yeah,
right?
Yeah.
If you have an option to fail, genuinely fail, you are no longer following the hero's journey. You are no longer epic. You are no longer in the mold of awesome.
Mm-hmm.
You suck.
That immediately takes me back to the thing that we always talk, mm-hmm, about, especially in classes, is the Prince of Persia, you know, the first 3D one,
yeah,
where they...
Sands of Time, yeah.
Yeah, Sands of Time, mm-hmm, where, you know, when you die, quote unquote, you know, you have a narrative justification. It's like, oh, no, wait, that's not how it happened.
Yeah.
You know, and it resumes from a game over screen and, oh, no, that didn't actually happen. Don't worry about it.
Mm-hmm.
You know, whereas, you know, failure in other games, and this is another thing that I can't harp on enough, is quick time events.
Mm-hmm.
If you fail most quick time events, you die. And it's like, okay, we'll try it again and hit the buttons right this time, you idiot. You know, whereas in, I think The Wolf Among Us did a really great job of this, is I think QuickTime events should be narrative events. And if you mess up a QuickTime event, the game keeps going, just something different happens.
It's like,
you
know, life.
And there were a few places, both in The Wolf Among Us and The Walking Dead, where if you miss like the dodge, then you get stabbed and you have to go back, you know, a few
times. They definitely have their moments where it's like, okay, fail, game over.
Can you die? You know, if you can actually die and fail in Wolf Among Us?
Yes, it happens in the first episode.
Okay.
Yeah.
So I know that happens.
I didn't know that.
I didn't know that either. That's why I asked.
Yep.
So I know it happens in Walking Dead, at least season one.
And to be fair, I mean, they don't put you too far back. It's not like you have to restart the whole fight. It's just a sequence of the fight. You just have to make sure you get it right this time.
So my big question is this. Are we setting out to make games that make us believe we are Beowulf? Or are we making games that allow us to identify those who truly are?
Well, I think you
the
can...
The elite few.
That's a good question.
It can do... I mean, it depends on the developer's concept of the game to begin with. They might want to give you the hero's journey experience, or they might want you to give you a different narrative experience each time you play, and the possibility of failure, and giving you a different story. So I think there's room for both types of games. The problem is that there's really just one right now.
I think I would actually interject and say that that's not even on the table right now for most developers.
Yeah, yeah.
I would say that narrative and mechanics are conflicting more now, even in this like really advanced age of gaming, more than they ever have. I think narratives feel more slapped on than they ever have before, and I think gameplay feels more slapped on to certain narrative games, you know?
Yeah.
So I think that
I agree.
Before that sort of advancement towards an ideal, you know, heroification, I guess you could call it, happens, people need to actually give narrative and mechanics the proper respect that they need and not think of them in separate camps and realize that they're the same thing, you know?
Mm-hmm. And then once we figure all that out, we're going to have to decide how much control we're going to give to the player.
And yeah.
Whose story are we telling?
Mm-hmm.
Minecraft has no plot. You have complete control over what you do. That's the best thing about the game. Exactly. But it would make a terrible game engine if you were... Well, trying to tell Wolf Among Us is an example.
Yeah, and that's another thing that I think that people don't really understand about the narrative across different media. So with role-playing games and tabletop games, you have a sort of environmental and procedurally narrated story. And in certain games, you can have a prescriptive narrative. But for example, let's take like Spelunky. There is totally a narrative to Spelunky. The enemies in that game have personalities. The snakes, they're tricky. The way that they rear up before they're about to attack, and that's like your sign that they're going to attack, but sometimes they won't. Sometimes they'll fake you out. They won't do it, you know? So there's lots of different narrative and personality-based story elements to mechanical gameplay, and I think that that's something that... games have that you don't really need to worry about in traditional storytelling, either linear filmic storytelling or open, you know, around the table storytelling. So I think that might be one of the issues that games are encountering, is that people aren't really utilizing mechanics for the sake of narrative, and they're not utilizing narrative to put mechanics into context.
Yep, and I think there's some games that do a good job of having the mechanics sort of have narrative elements or narrative effects to them, but then sometimes they lean on too much and totally neglect every other type of narrative. Mm-hmm. And so it's tricky finding just that right balance for the type of game you're doing. So
yep.
So I'm curious what everybody else's GMing philosophy is. I gave you mine.
We can go ahead and wrap up on that note, too.
Sure, that sounds good.
So mine is, I actually attempt to never railroad. Will is in a game that I've been GMing for the past year and a half, 2 years, that we haven't played recently.
Yeah.
I essentially set them out on a, think of it as like a sandbox. I develop the whole world. I spent, you know, God knows how many months, like, writing up a world-building journal.
Okay.
And I set sort of objectives and quests around the world, and then I set time ticking. Mm-hmm. So the players have control over what they do, where they go, etc. And I've got stuff that's going to happen on this day at this time, etc. And if they don't do it, then they don't do
it. Sounds kind of like Dungeon World, but pre-planned.
Yeah.
And I totally respect that style of GMing. I'm just way too lazy to do it.
I like to think of the way I GM as essentially Majora's Mask meets D&D.
Awesome.
So there's a path that's occurring, mm-hmm. and players can do things at those different times that, you know, they're going to happen, but what are you going to do about it?
Right. Cool. That's kind of what I wish Skyrim would do. And
for sure.
So,
Jim?
Oh, okay. I was going to say, I guess it's been a little while since I have GM'd a game, but normally what I'd like to do is sort of have a general quest goal in mind, but I want to make sure that I usually like to center it around one sort of town and kind of give them the illusion they can go kind of anywhere, but they can't really. But I make sure that I develop the interior of the town well enough so that they can have a bunch of interactions in terms of dealing with NPCs, shops, citizens, yeah. Because I know that one of the things that the people that I normally play with like a lot is interactions, sometimes violent interactions, sometimes sexual interactions with random people, because it's usually a lot of the times the people I'll play with, they'll want to one-up each other in terms of doing something ridiculous or stupid or kind of funny, mm-hmm. and so you have to give them opportunities to do that.
Sure.
That's a very Fate-like approach, actually.
When I'm playing a mechanics-heavy game like Dungeons & Dragons, I love that kind of campaign where, mm-hmm. like, it takes place in a city that the GM
The
hub city, where the GM can tell you, like, this is this district and this is this district, mm-hmm. you know, etc., and, like, you have guilds established and social structures and all of that, and so it's just this very fleshed out huge city, and that I think plays really well into the mechanics heavy systems.
Yeah, cool. So how about you, Will?
So I actually prefer one shots. I prefer short stories to novels, so the one shot systems work a lot better for the way I do things. But I did fairly recently run a game where it was a series of four different one shots that were tied together unbeknownst to the players. And the reason that I preferred that is because it allowed me to railroad the small term game, but while they were playing, they could treat that mission however they wanted, and it affected the rest of it. And in that way, I was able to, you finish this, you've completed it, you're on to the next one. Well, what you did there affected your next game.
Right.
You don't know it yet, but it has.
Nice.
I also tend to play with people who actually prefer railroading. It's kind of weird. They like playing games more. They like telling stories and playing games, so they really enjoy a set path, like seeing something that's there with the ability to diverge if they want to.
Mm-hmm.
So I build out a framework with key points and then let them reach those points however they want.
Gotcha.
And if they decide not to hit any of those points, I throw in something else and stall with another story on what they're doing until the next week where I can just write something else.
Nice.
So,
cool. Doc, how about you?
Well, as I said, I always like to be able to have, I call it modular content that I can insert into anything that's linear. But truthfully, my favorite way of running it is without having any kind of content at all. I usually try to think of it in terms of there's a ring and it needs to be put into the volcano, and you guys are going to create your characters and go. And everything is emergent based on that. I truly love to be challenged on the fly. I used to own a private school that had kids with lots of different learning differences, and you know, everything from ADD all the way up through Asperger's and autism. And some of my favorite games came whenever it was just a group of kids with Asperger's sitting around the table, and one of the definitions of that is lack of social understanding. And I used to use that as a teachable moment. Fantastic. And one of my favorite anecdotes is about a kid that I had, a student of mine. His name was David. And he's an adult now. Still keep in touch with him. Great guy.
Cool.
But at that time, he really didn't fully understand all the implications of his actions. But in the role-playing game, he was playing a healer. And there was a situation where the woman had a sick daughter upstairs, and she said, "No, you can't come inside. I've heard about you. You use dark magic." And he said, "No, I'm going to heal your daughter." Kicked open the door, ran upstairs, healed the daughter, and by the time he got downstairs, the militia were there. And the next scene, they're being chased out of town. The whole party's being chased out of town with pitchforks and torches. And we had to have a sort of a stop and understand why that happened kind of a moment. So I want to say, yeah, it's fun in games, but actually I think there's a lot to be had from roleplay as a tool, as an education tool. As a social tool. And I think that one of the most powerful things that we do as humans is storytell. You know, a colleague of mine, Dr. Turner,
to Portugal.
Yeah, no kidding. Dr. Turner, a colleague of mine, said that we story told ourselves into existence, and I find that to be one of those powerful statements I've ever heard. So I'm never going to stop, and I know you guys won't either.
And I'll just quickly summarize mine. It's actually very similar to yours, Doc. I think some of that's because I learned most of what I know about RPGs from you. So from your class.
That's like terrifying.
That. Well, your undergrad class was actually the first time I actually got into role playing games, so that might explain something. But yeah, no, I think I go into it with kind of a generalized, like, here's where they're going to start, here's where it's supposedly supposed to end, and sometimes we'll sort of come up with a session-by-session ending. But for the most part, I'd let them figure out how to get to that end on their own. And I think one of my weaker points with that is making the objective strong enough that they really feel like they want to or need to get to it. Otherwise, they might get distracted a little bit too easily. So that is a bit of a challenge, and I'm learning how to do that. I haven't GM'd too many campaigns, but most of the campaigns I've been in, I've GM'd, so it's kind of weird. I'm very new to this.
And
so
how many systems have you created now?
You see, that's a trick question, because the ones that I've finished and been happy with, very, very few. But
that's fair. I know of at least four that you've done.
Yeah, so. Four or five, and that's not counting like the little tiny storytelling games. So
anyway. We accept your humility, but...
All right, well, this has definitely been one of our longer podcasts, but also one of our more fun and... I think, yeah, Ben was the only one. No, that was a third person, or a third three-person podcast, because I was out of town.
Yes, right. This is our biggest.
Yeah, all right. Well, thanks for joining us here, guys. This has been our seventh podcast, right?
This is number seven.
Number seven.
Yeah, we're racking them up, man.
Seven?
All right. Well, thanks for joining us and listening to us go on and on about storytelling and interactive narrative in different genres and... modes of gameplay, and listening to a bunch of terrible haikus. Yep. No, some of Chris's were pretty good.
Yeah, I was gonna say I believe Will and I had that about once.
No, Will, yeah. Your Gandhi haiku.
I did enjoy the wubs. So
yes.
Anyway, so that'll be it for us today. I'm Chris.
I'm Richard.
I'm Jim.
And we're here with
Doc.
I'm pointing at you. See, you guys can't see my gesture, but I'm kind of gesturing at Doc right now to introduce
him. It was an obscene gesture.
I was waiting for the opportunity to reprise my haiku.
Oh, really?
Yeah, make them pay with life. I want to kill them all now. I like the GM.
Oh, yeah, we're going to do that now.
And we're here with Will, and with that, we're about to go die. So, thanks for joining us.
I will survive.
Thank you. Once more into the breach.
Thanks for joining us. See you next time.
Bye.
We want you to join the discussion on our website, backward-compatible.com. You bring a unique perspective, and dialogue makes everyone better. Leave a comment in our podcast section, and if it's good, one of the crew members will respond to it. This time, tell us about your approach to running or playing RPGs. And hey, if you have anything else to say, lay it on us. We're all ears. Thanks for listening. Until next time, stay compatible.